Hi, my name is Scott Markley. I'm the lead pastor here at First Baptist Church of Lake Wales. We are so thrilled that you are checking out this broadcast of our services here at First Baptist. We trust that you will encounter God this day as you watch the broadcast through dynamic worship and through His Word. May He minister to you this day.
Separate, even if I ran away, your love never fails. No, I still make mistakes. You have been mercies for me every day. Your love never fails. Stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. For my good, you made blind, there's no one like you. None like you. And into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are high. If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? Then if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? Then if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
Come in and worship with us. So if you're new with us, I brought in my guest card. If you do us a favor, fill out that guest card, put it in the offering plate later when it comes by. Let us know who you are. We'll get in touch with you and then let you know about some ministries that may be very important to you. And so on the back is also a place for you to write a prayer request, something that you want the pastors to pray for. You can also write that down, that you could be new or a longtime person here. And we would love to pray for that. You can put that there in the offering plate. So let's do this. We're going to continue in worship. But before we do, turn around and say hello to those that are right around you.
stark wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power. To the King of Kings, you are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, was, it is, and is to come. All creation I sing praise to.
Seated. We're going to sing some musical worship at the end today. We're going to do a couple songs, so don't slip out. At the end of the message, we're going to continue in worship in response to God's word today. But right now, we're going to spend some time in scriptures. Let's pray together and ask God to open our hearts to his word. Father, we just do praise and adore you. Lord, we thank you. We worship you. Lord, we express all adoration and honor, ascribe all glory and worth to you. For you alone are to be praised. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. And Lord, we join all of creation in extolling your praise and your virtues, Lord. You've made manifest your goodness to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, who was the purchase price needed to redeem us from our sins, to bring us to you for salvation now and forevermore. Lord, we give thanks to you for all that you've done to make for yourself a people from ages past to this present time and until the time you determine to return and bring things all together, establish your eternal kingdom, the new heavens and new earth, Lord, and we look forward to all of your plan unfolding. Lord, thank you for walking with Tammy Little so many years of her life and giving us an example of a sister who loved you and served you, Lord, with all that you gave her from her teenage years onward. And a lot of that included her piano playing, but far more than that, Lord. We thank you for the worshiper she was and now the worshiper she is with you. Thank you for the example of faith that the family's been to us through this, for the care they gave their mother and wife and daughter. Spectacular care, Lord. I can't imagine a family loving a loved one any more than they have, Lord. Every time I go to see her, they were there and tirelessly in their care for her. And so we pray you'd give them rest now from a season of caregiving that's extended for years. Lord, may you show them what is next for them as that role has been taken from their lives. Lord, I pray you continue to give them hearts seek after you as Tammy's did. And Lord, thank you for the love and support I know they felt from the church yesterday as they've given that to others. Now it came back to them as it should. And Lord, I thank you for that. Lord, thank you for those who continue in their fight against disease and sickness, Lord. I think of Jimmy Bolden and Jerry Miller and many others, Lord, those who've had success even this week. We are so grateful for Ambry's successful surgery and returning home the end of the week, and for Sarah, home recovering, though she's having issues this day. Lord, we ask you to be with her. Pray the wounds would heal, her body would recover from the trauma of surgery. You continue to give her strength for the battle that's still yet ahead.
For Susie Hollins, good news. We pray you continue to be with her. For Jack McGowan, doing a little better. We pray for him, for Kay, for the homes. Lord, others who have these needs yet are experiencing some recovery. Lord, we pray you continue to speed that recovery onward. For strength and healing for each. Pray for Donna Spurlock in a severe situation over in Winter Haven Hospital right now, Melinda's mother. We pray you'd be with her and those attending to her. Lord, give them wisdom and understanding of how to treat the infection that's in her body to get it out, Lord. We know how dangerous it is, and so please, we pray, give them insight and a proper procedure to move forward with her. Lord, others have relational needs here that are struggling in relationships or maybe needing guidance and direction. Lord, I pray you'd give them wisdom, counsel from your word, from godly people. Lord, to be open to what you would say to them about those relationships, Lord, and they would want to walk in your wisdom in those relationships. Lord, for others who have decisions to make about careers, jobs, some have big meetings this week, appointments. Pray you bless those, that you give them peace in those situations. You give them words to say or not to say in the appropriate conversations that will happen. Lord, we pray you give us wisdom in our finances, that we use the resources you give us well. Lord, you see the need in our church. We pray you continue to be faithful in our giving to meet those needs. Lord, thank you for the response churches have had to the Bahamas as well as our country. And we pray we continue to give aid there where needed, protect those who are going to rebuild from those who mean harm, those who are wicked and evildoers committing sad and atrocious sins against neighbors and property and looting and all those things. We pray you enable law and order to be able to be reestablished in those parts where it has been tested. Lord, we just pray now that you'd open our hearts to your word, what you have to say to us, Lord. Pray we'd learn through these speeches that Job and his friends give, more about you, more about what it means to walk with you, to live according to your truth in our world today. Lord, how to respond to others in their times of adversity, and how we should respond with your trust in you through our times of adversity that may indeed be coming soon. So Lord, help us to be the people you've called us to be. Help us to love your gospel, proclaim your gospel, to live your gospel. May your word be evident in our lives as it was in Tammy's, Lord. And Lord, may we drink in your scripture this day, and may you fill us to the full measure of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. So when does a friend cease to be a friend? Hopefully never, right? That's what I hope for you. Never. When does a friend cease to be a friend? Well, you might say, after you read these chapters ahead in the book of Job, a friend ceases to be a friend when that friend acts like Job's friends. You're going to see that they're not exceptionally friendly. In fact, indeed, I think we could say at the least that they become unfriendly to Job in the chapter 4 through 27, a bunch of speeches these guys give. Now, these friends started out well. Indeed, that's what they're called. Job chapter 2, verse 11, that scripture on the screen for you, shows that these guys, these three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, Zophar, were called friends. Friends. But as they begin to speak, you're going to see it seems like they're anything but that. They did well, we saw last week, right? End of chapter 2, they did quite well at the beginning. They came and they sat with their friend in ashes. He's sitting out by the garbage heap where the trash is burning in the city. That's the way they dispose of their trash at that period of history. And that's where outcasts would be, on the outskirts of town. Lepers and others. Indeed, Job himself may have had leprosy, but whatever infirmity he has, it soars from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. And for 7 days, his friends sat there with him, saying nothing. Just being his friends. The ministry of presence, we talked about it last week. But then Job gave that speech we looked at the end of last week in chapter 3. We read of it, and at that point, it seems things change. The mood changes. The attitude of these friends changes dramatically. Now, I've labeled these middle chapters of the book, I'll call them middle, 4 through 27. I've labeled these chapters dialogue. Maybe we could probably rightly call it debate. That seems to be what's going on. They each are going to give speeches. They're going to, in these speeches, really be accusatory of Job. And Job himself then, of course, put on the defense, speaks in ways where he tries to defend himself against them. I've called them rounds because they remind me of of rounds. I visualize in my mind, you know, a boxing match, and these guys are coming in and they're taking turns with blows at Job, and he's just trying to defend them off with his words. And yet almost like, more like, I guess, wrestling, WWE or something, there's tag team going on. And so one guy will give his speech attacking Job and accusing Job of sin. And then the other comes in, and next round, and he's going to waylay Job with some of his words. And then a third one, as we'll see today, three rounds we're going to look at today of this piling on Job with their accusations, their criticisms. They're trying to get him to confess his sin. So if you have your Bible, we're going to skim through these passages. It's going to be kind of quick. And so if you have your Bible, it'll be helpful for you to follow along in that way, or your device, look at that. And you can, if you can move quickly through it. If not, we'll put the words on the screen. Jan's done a great job of putting these here for you. And we'll move through a lot of slides as we read through this book of Job. And so we begin round one with a guy named Eliphaz. Eliphaz, probably the oldest of the three. It's thought that these guys spoke perhaps in birth order, as would be customary for the culture of that day, deferring to the oldest first. And so Eliphaz begins speaking, and here's what we read. Job chapter 4, and I'm reading out of the ESV today. Job chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. It says, "Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered and said, 'If one ventures a word with you, will you be impatient? Yet who can keep from speaking? Behold, you've instructed many, and you've strengthened the weak hands. Your words have upheld him who was stumbling, and you have made firm the feeble knees.'" Eliphaz is talking about Job, what Job has done, how he's helped others. Then he says, verse 5, "But now it has come to you, and you're impatient. It touches you, and you're dismayed. Is not your fear of God your confidence, and the integrity of your ways your hope? Remember, who that was innocent ever perished? Or where were the upright cut off? As I have seen those who plow iniquity and sow trouble reap the same." See, Eliphaz starts in kind of gently on him. Actually, he's commending him, isn't he? In the first verses, look at this ministry you've had to others. You've instructed, you've strengthened, you've upheld people. But oh, now it's come on you. What's the problem, buddy? He says to him. And then at the end, the implication clear of this agricultural metaphor, that those who plow iniquity, sow trouble, reap the same. So now you're upset, Job, because you're reaping what you sow. The problem with Eliphaz's assessment is that's not what's happening. If you've read Job 1 and 2, which we have, if you've been here, if not, go back and read it. I invite you, because you don't really understand what's going on. Job's going to come off like a self-righteous jerk if you don't read chapter 1 and 2. But when you read that, you go, no, that's not the case. He's not reaping what he's sown. Not at all. Not by God's assessment of him. He hasn't sowed trouble or plowed iniquity. That's not what he's reaping. But these Eliphaz and his friends, these friends of Job, they subscribe essentially to the axiom that says the righteous will prosper and the wicked will suffer. But that's not always true. Indeed, sowing sin does mean reaping judgment, as it says in Galatians 6, 7 and 9, and 1 Peter 3, 12. But we do not always, in immediate circumstance, reap what we sow, not in kind or portion. Job certainly is not. We know from chapters 1 and 2 Job's integrity of heart. We know he was blameless, assessed so by God, hated evil, feared God. But Eliphaz, in his mind, there's one explanation for suffering and sin, and it must be you have sinned. It's judgment by God. Their theology essentially functions by this syllogism. All suffering is a result of sin. Job is suffering, therefore Job sinned. That's what they believe, and you're going to hear it in the chapters ahead, over and over again. It's that simple to them. And frankly, Job has the same perspective on the first point, right? All suffering is a result of sin. That's his theology as well, as many in the Old Testament thought that way. But Job's dilemma is, I didn't do anything wrong. So why am I suffering as I am? Not that he's sinless. We'll see that today. But he knows he didn't do anything to seemingly merit the horrible affliction he's experienced, and also the devastating loss of his 10 children all being killed, and all of his herds on top of that also being taken away, stolen, or killed. So he doesn't understand either. Now, I think it's important to say, even as we come into these weeks of looking at the conversation, to lay in the backdrop these verses, rightly we should read them probably every week, John chapter 9, verses 1 through 3, because this forever makes it very clear to us that people do not always suffer because of sin, that there is suffering in this life that is not a result of sin. And so Jesus forever makes that plain in John chapter 9. So we lay this in the backdrop. John chapter 9, it reads like this: as he went along, this is speaking of Jesus, he saw a man born blind, a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, master, teacher, rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" That's their thinking, right? It's the way of thinking. He must have sinned or his parents sinned, and they're being judged. But Jesus said, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him." Forever setting clear to us, there are people that suffer in life not because they've done something wrong, but for in some way that God wants glory to be seen through their lives, through their affliction, through their suffering. So the syllogism is untrue. Jesus makes it plain, not all suffering is a result of sin. I cannot say it enough, but we're going to see that is the thinking of these friends of Joseph. Now, Eliphaz thinks he's right. And the basis for his authority, why he feels he's right, is this vision he had, verses 12 through 17 of the chapter. Look there, he says, "Now a word was brought to me stealthily. My ear received the whisper of it. Amid thoughts from visions of the night, when deep sleep falls on men, dread came upon me and trembling, which made all my bones shake. A spirit glided past my face. The hair of my flesh stood up. It stood still, but I could not discern its appearance. A form was before my eyes. There was silence, and then I heard a voice. Can mortal man be in the right before God? Can a man be pure before his maker?" That's the question that came to him in this vision he had, this dream. Whoa. And he perceived it to be a vision given of God, that God, in fact, is speaking to him, asking this question: can a mortal man be in the right before God? Can, then applied to Job, can Job be right before God? Can he be pure before God? Surely not. That's his conclusion. That's Eliphaz's conclusion, that Job is in the wrong. How can Job assert he's pure and sinless? If Job's suffering, clearly he's sinned. To say otherwise is to say God and this vision is wrong. Say Job is right is to say God's wrong, and Eliphaz has refused to do that. How can a mortal man be in the right, he says, based on his vision? But Eliphaz aims his words then more directly at Job. In chapter 5, verses 1 through 3, he speaks and says, "Call now, is there anyone who will answer you?" He's speaking to Job. "To which of the holy ones will you turn?" As if there's no one for him to turn to. "Surely vexation kills the fool, and jealousy slays the simple. I have seen the fool taking root, but suddenly I cursed his dwelling." He's calling Job a fool. Essentially saying there's no heavenly intercessor for you, Job. Who are you going to call on? Chapter 5, verses 6 through 10. "For affliction does not come from the dust, nor does trouble sprout from the ground, but man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward." True. Trouble comes to us all, doesn't it? Verse 8, "As for me, I would seek God, and to God would I commit my cause, who does great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number. He gives rain on the earth and sends waters on the fields." Indeed, that's true, isn't it? Now understand what these friends say. Some of what they're going to say is true. Some of what they're going to say is not true. God will assess it in the end, chapter 42, but for now you must assess it as you read and be discerning. Don't dismiss all that they say as false. Verse 13, he continues to speak of this great God. He catches the wise in their own craftiness. Verse 15, but he saves the needy from the sword of their mouth. Verse 17, behold, blessed is the one whom God reproves. Therefore despise not the discipline of the Almighty, he's telling Job. For he wounds, but he binds up. He shatters, but his hands heal. There's some hopeful verses there, but verses that remind you, perhaps, if you've read the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 12, we're told to value the discipline of the Lord because the Lord disciplines those he loves as a father, the son he delights in. And that no discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who've been trained by it, it being the discipline. That God produces something in us, a harvest of righteousness and peace, the writer of Hebrews says, as we're trained through discipline. And so he's not wrong to say that the one God reproves or disciplines is actually blessed in the discipline of the Lord. Teaches us right from wrong. As we discipline our children, we teach them what right and wrong is through that, right? The problem is he's assuming that that's what's happening to Job, that Job is being disciplined or reproved by the Lord through his affliction and the loss that he experienced, which is not the case at all. He's saying he's not seeking God. You need to seek God. He's assuming he's not seeking God. And so Job then, in turn, will now defend himself against Eliphaz and these comments he's made. His speech begins in chapter 6 and runs through chapter 7. Look in 6, 1 through 4. Job says this, Job answered and said, "Oh, that my vexation were weighed, and all my calamity laid in the balances, for then it would be heavier than the sand of the sea. Therefore, my words have been rash, for the arrows of the Almighty are in me. My spirit drinks their poison. The terrors of God are arrayed against me." Job feels God's picking on him, doesn't he? That God shot him with poisonous arrows, bringing him this pain that he's dealing. He's speaking as one who has chronic pain. Understand this disease has afflicted him so, and it's continuing to bring pain to him. And so he feels God's attacking him. Verse 8 continues on, "Oh, that I might have my request, and that God would fulfill my hope, that it would please God to crush me, that he would let loose his hand and just cut me off. This would be my comfort. I would even exult in pain unsparing, for I have not denied the words of the Holy One." The end of verse 10, he's saying, look, I didn't do it. I didn't deny God's words. I have not turned against God. And so I just wish he'd end it all. That's what he means by cut off. I just wish God would kill me. Now he's kind of in that thinking where his wife is. It's about as close as he comes to, I guess you'd call them, suicidal thoughts. He's not saying that, though. He's just saying that's how he feels. And maybe you've been there. Severe pain. Depressed. Wishing you weren't alive. And that's him. I just wish God would crush me, he says. 6:14, he who withholds kindness from a friend. Now he turns on his friend. Watch this. "He who withholds kindness from a friend forsakes the fear of the Almighty." He's speaking to Eliphaz at that point, not to God anymore. He's saying, you've said nothing of kindness to me. So where is your fear of the Almighty? Surely you don't seem to fear him if you speak to me the way you do. Then in 6:24, he says, "Okay, Eliphaz, show me my sin. Teach me, and I will be silent. Make me understand how I've gone astray." Eliphaz, name it. "What do you think I've done that's deserving of this? Loss of 10 children, all my crops, this disease I now sit with here day after day, week after week. You think I deserve this?" And then Job laments the brevity of life. In chapter 7, skip that. You can read it on your own. Verse 11, he makes three I will statements. "Therefore, I will not restrain my mouth. I will speak in the anguish of my spirit. I will complain in the bitterness of my soul." No guessing where he's at, is it? You know where he's at psychologically. You know where he's at. He's struggling. He's bitter. He's angry. He's hurting. Then in an ironic twist, in chapter 7, verse 17, even before that, "Leave me alone, for my days are a breath. What is man that you make so much of him, that you set your heart on him?" Notice that's a reversal of Psalm 8. We studied Psalm 8. Some of you were here this summer. We looked at Psalm 8. Psalm 8, David's writing. He says, what is man that you're mindful of him? He says to God, "The son of man that you take thought of him." See, David writes about that. David's saying that God's mindful of him makes David feel protected, makes him feel secure, makes him, it's a sign of affection. Oh, but not Job in this instance, is it? Rather, Job is overwhelmed. He's threatened. He feels closed in by God. He feels trapped. Notice the fact that God's watching over him. It's so intimidating. In verse 19, graphically, he says this, "How long will you not look away from me, nor leave me alone till I swallow my spit?" It's very graphic. I can't even swallow. And you're watching me. He acknowledges the omniscience of God, that God is all-knowing, that God is sovereign over all, that God sees everything he does. And yet he feels overcome by it, overwhelmed by it. And he concludes his first defense in verses 20 through 21. Job writes, if I sin, what do I do to you, you watcher of mankind? I have that underlined in my Bible, watcher of mankind. It's a label he gives. If I sin, what do I do to you, you watcher of mankind? Why have you made me your mark? Why have I become a burden to you? Why do you not pardon my transgression and take away my iniquity? Oh, see, he does see. He's a sinner. My transgression, my iniquity. He never said he was sinless. He's assessed as blameless, not sinless. There's a difference. So Job says that God is the watcher of mankind. He knows our sin, and he has the power to forgive sin. Also, notice Job saying. Do you agree? Now, you may not be troubled by God as the watcher of mankind, but I wonder if some other people might be the watcher of mankind, if that might intimidate you a little bit. Remember the 2013 NSA spying controversy in our country? Many were up in arms, thinking Big Brother might be watching you, right? Wall Street Journal ran an article not too long ago titled, "Phones Leave a Telltale Trail." The authors noted that everyone who owns a cell phone creates metadata that leaves a digital trail. Many of you know this. And every crumb of data may seem insignificant, but when combined and analyzed, that article, they once said, was, quote, one of the most powerful investigative tools ever devised, your metadata. See, by tracing our metadata, investigators can pinpoint where we are or where we were at any given moment. Here's an example. Let's use an imaginary smartphone user named Jeff. Jeff poses by a waterfall, snaps his self-portrait, which he immediately tweets, then emails to his grandmother. Jeff's text, photo, and email all ascend a series of remote servers, each dragging their own trails of metadata. Once there, the metadata may be extracted and interpreted by any party who has access. Thanks to the above digital trail, without ever having met Jeff, we may know that he was at Shoshone Falls near Twin Falls, Idaho, at 3:57 p.m. on April 22nd, and that he has a certain brand of smartphone and that he speaks English. Now, that may not threaten you here in America, but maybe you should know that such technology is already being used right now in China as a means of social control over the citizens of that country. They have become a surveillance state using digital espionage on their own people. For the information they gain as the watcher of mankind in China, they assign social credits to reward and punish behavior that they deem good or bad. And I assure you that they are not as forgiving of transgressions as God is. Yet in Job's state of mind, he feels as threatened as the people of China do today. However, he had the clarity of mind to remember that God does forgive. Indeed, God doesn't watch us to control us or for punitive purposes, but rather to assure us that he is there to guide us and to guard us. Sure, through his Spirit, he also brings conviction, but he also forgives and restores those who turn from their sin. So there's round one, Eliphaz and Job. Round two, Bildad. Chapter 8 is where we begin it. Chapter 8, we're going to see Bildad. Now, he enters the ring kind of like, he definitely like, I didn't watch a lot of WWE, but I think you would say he comes from the top rope with a pile driver. He's going to do one of the, his, what they call a stone cold stunner, right? He's going to come, whoa, and bring it down on Job. He has a blunt blast of words. Listen to these words, chapter 8. Verses 1 through 7. Then Bildad the Shuhite answered and said, "How long will you say these things, and the words of your mouth be a great wind?" He's calling him a blowhard. "Does God pervert justice? Or does the Almighty pervert the right? Ooh. If your children have sinned against them, he has delivered them into the hand of their transgression." You hear that? "If you will seek God and plead with the Almighty for mercy, if you are pure and upright, surely then he will rouse himself for you and restore your rightful habitation. And though your beginning was small, your latter days will be very great." Now he comes in with some hard, hard words. And notice for him, verse 3 is a key verse. Does God pervert justice? In Bildad's mind, this is all about the justice of God. God is unjust. If you've sinned, then he doesn't punish you. See, God just executing his justice by punishing you. You've done wrong. You won't admit it, but we know it. That's why you're suffering this. If God was unjust, you wouldn't be suffering, but because he is just, you are suffering. To say otherwise is to accuse God of being unjust. That's his point. He's implying Job's children have sinned also. Verse 3, striking, isn't it? Can you believe anybody would say that? He's saying they got what they deserved. If your children have sinned against him, He delivered them into the hand of their transgression. It's horrible. Can you imagine saying that to someone? But Bildad does. He goes on, verse 8. For inquire, please, of bygone ages, and consider what the fathers have searched out. For we are but of yesterday and know nothing. For our days on earth are a shadow. He's saying, look, you and I, we just got here. Look at the teachings of those who've gone before us. Is this not what they've taught us? That sin and suffering is a result of the judgment of God. Then in verses 11 through 19, you can read on your own. He gives three analogies. And then 20 through 22, he pleads with Job as he concludes his speech. Behold, God will not reject a blameless man, nor take the hand of evildoers. He will yet fill your mouth with laughter and your lips with shouting. Those who hate you will be clothed with shame, and the tent of the wicked will be no more. Now notice that he's saying he's not going to reject a blameless man, implying what? That Job's not blameless. Yet again, if you read chapter 1 and 2, what was he called? Blameless. He's saying the very thing that God said he wasn't, or was, he's saying he isn't. Bad application of correct theology. Again, your suffering or your kid's suffering must be proof of your sin. He still calls him blameless even though God said he's not. He's listening with his ears but not his heart. His words are heartless, they're cruel. So Job responds, chapter 9 and following. 9, 1 through 8 reads like this. Then Job answered and said, truly I know that it is so, but how can a man be right before God? Have we heard that before? Yes, chapter 4, 17. That's what Eliphaz said, right? So Job repeats the question. How can a man be in the right before God? If one wished to contend with him, one could not answer him once in 1,000 times. He is wise in heart and mighty in strength. Who has hardened himself against him and succeeded? The answer would be no one. Verse 5, he who removes mountains and they know it not, when he overturns them in his anger, who shakes the earth out of its place and its pillars tremble. Pillars are the mountains. He's talking about earthquakes. Who commands the sun and it does not rise, who seals up the stars, who alone stretched out the heavens and trampled the waves of the sea. See the visual image that the waves come in the sea, for it's God walking there, and the waves crash up. Very vivid. Trying to help him understand, look, Bill, that I know this God is creator. In fact, I know him as creator, and because he's mighty creator, who am I to contend with? I can't fight with God. That's not a fair case. I remember my dad telling me about an old book he read. Said, your arms are too short to box with God. Indeed, that's what he's saying, right? You got no chance. You're not going to win a legal case with him. You're not going to win a boxing match with God. So he has no small view of God. And Bildad contends God is fair. Job is contending, no, this isn't fair. He continues on, verse 15. Though I am in the right, I cannot answer him. I must appeal for mercy to my accuser. If I summoned him and he answered me, I would not believe that he was listening to my voice. For he crushes me with a tempest and multiplies my wounds without cause. He will not let me get my breath, but fills me with bitterness. It is a contest of strength. Behold, he is mighty. If it is a matter of justice, who can summon him? Again, he's saying, I have no chance. And then furthermore, he's going to say that he has no arbiter, no intermediary, no one to plead his case, to bring about peace between him and God. Verses 32 and 33 of chapter 9. For he is not a man as I am, that I might answer him, that we should come to trial together. 33. There is no arbiter between us who might lay his hand on us both. You hear the despair. The despair. Chapter 10. Verse 1, I loathe my life. I will give free utterance to my complaint. I will speak in the bitterness of my soul. Verse 9, remember that you've made me like clay and will return me to the dust. Verse 12, you've granted me life and steadfast love, and your care has preserved my spirit. He said, Lord, the only reason I'm here is because you made me. And you made me like this. You made me inferior to you. You made me of clay. And so kind of sarcastically he's saying, and what's the point of it all? You make me for this brief while I suffer? And then I die and that's it? Why? Job feels helpless. He feels hopeless. But what's Job leaving out? What's he missing? What does he not know? That there is an arbiter. There is an intermediary. There is a heavenly intercessor. There is someone who can become between God and man. And who is it? It's the God-man, Jesus Christ. He's the one who will be your advocate, your defense attorney, one who will argue your case before God. We find it in 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 through 2, in that same kind of legal motif. Quite plainly we read in 1 John, "My dear children," John writes, "I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an," what? "Advocate," like a defense attorney. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. That's why he can defend you. He doesn't need to defend himself. He's the righteous one. He's the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. He's saying that Jesus is our advocate. He's the one that Job longed for, this arbiter, the one who would speak to the Father in his defense. Not only speak to the Father, but also do something about our sin penalty. Verse 2, that he would be the atoning sacrifice, pay the just penalty for our sin. He defended us then, we see in verses 1 and 2 of 1 John 2, not just with words, but with actions. He advocated and acted in our defense. I was reading a bizarre story about a defense attorney. Really bizarre. The things he did for his client, he did both of those things for his client as well. Video footage is there of a courtroom in Florida that showed a judge named John Murphy started arguing with a defense attorney named Andrew Weinstock there to the left in that picture. I won't say where they were, but they were in Florida, only in Florida, right? They were arguing about whether Weinstock should waive the right for his client to have a speedy trial. Judge Murphy was trying to convince Weinstock to do that. Weinstock was balking at the thought, wasn't having any of it. So the war of words continued, and finally Judge Murphy said this. He said, "You know, if I had a rock, I would throw it at you right now. Just sit down." Weinstock responded, "Well, you know, I'm the public defender, and I have a right to be here, and have a right to stand and represent my client." So in the video, shockingly, the judge, Judge Murphy, then challenged Weinstock to go out back where the video cameras wouldn't catch them. Yeah, he said on video, "If you want to fight, let's go out back." Equally shocking, Weinstock agrees. Leaves the courtroom. They go out back. You can't see anything on the cameras in the courtroom, but you can hear scuffling. You can hear a few loud thuds. And you know that a couple deputies went through that door and they broke it up. Unbelievable. This guy Weinstock would do nothing, spare nothing to defend his client, apparently. Of course, Weinstock was reassigned to a different judge, different courtroom, and Judge Murphy had to take a leave of absence to seek some anger management counseling. Now, it's safe to say that when the Father spoke, or when the Son, Jesus Christ, spoke to the Father in your defense, it didn't end up like that. But the fact of the matter is, it ended up worse, didn't it? Because when he spoke to the Father in your defense, and he went to the Father in your defense, he ended up on a bloody cross. His Father and Son and Spirit agreed together that price must be paid for God to be just. And so Christ bore the just penalty for your sins as your advocate. He not only spoke, but he acted in your defense to clear you before God of all charges. That's what he's done for you, your advocate. If you've never asked him to do that today by faith, you can simply say, "Will you be my defender, my advocate? I give you my case, all my sin. I accept your death in my place, the penalty and the payment for my sin." Let me tell you what, he's the righteous one. He's never lost a case. Will you give him your case? He's the arbiter, the intermediary, the defender, the peacemaker that Job longed for and that each and every one of us need. Have you trusted him with your case? If not, why not today? The final verbal blast in these three rounds comes from a man named Zophar, probably the youngest. Zophar is ruthlessly judgmental. Chapter 11, Zophar the Naamathite answered and said, "Should a multitude of words go unanswered and a man full of talk be judged right? Should your babble silence man, and when you mock, shall no one shame you? For you say, 'My doctrine is pure, and I am clean in God's eyes.' But oh, that God would speak and open his lips to you, and that he would tell you the secrets of wisdom, for he is manifold in understanding. Know then that God exacts of you less than your guilt deserves. Can you find out the deep things of God? Can you find out the limit of the Almighty? It is higher than heaven. What can you do? Now this guy, he's Zophar, he's coming at it. Look, let me keep going. Look at 9. It's the measure. Its measure is longer than the earth and broader than the sea. If he passes through and imprisons and summons the court, who can turn it back? For he knows worthless men. When he sees iniquity, will he not consider it? So in verse 11, he's calling them worthless. Back in 1, full of talk. Verse 2, he's a babbler. He's insulting him. And do you get what he's saying in verse 6? You're getting less than your guilt deserves. I mean, it's like he's saying, well, it could be worse. Job's got to be thinking, how? Actually, he's not saying it could be worse. He's saying it should be worse, right? It should be worse. None of these guys understand sympathy, do they? A child understood it better than them when the child said, "Your sympathy is your pain in my heart. Your pain in my heart." Yet these three friends are indifferent to Job's pain. They seem to care less about his pain, his chronic pain. They pile on him, calling him a fool. Zophar thinks Job's presumptuous, ignorant of God, too stubborn to repent. So in 13 to 19, he continues, "If you prepare your heart," speaking of Job, "you will stretch out your hands." And this is a sincere appeal for repentance. No doubting the sincerity of these words. "If iniquity is in your hand, put it far away, and let not justice dwell in your tents." Good advice for all but probably Job. "Surely then you will lift up your face without blemish. You will be secure and will not fear. You will forget your misery. You will remember it as waters that have passed, and your life will be brighter than the noonday. Its darkness will be like the morning, and you will feel secure because there's hope. You will look around and take your rest in security. You will lie down, and none will make you afraid." He said, look, this is all waiting for you. If you turn from your sin, it's a great appeal, but it's a faulty premise. A premise, again, do what's right and all will go well. But you do what's wrong, it goes badly. God makes it go badly for you. Indeed, at the end of this life, the wicked, those who reject God, they will be judged. And the righteous who abide with God in faith will be vindicated before him. But it doesn't always play out like that in this earth, does it? People may repent and still suffer. All troublers are not absolved. All wicked are not judged immediately in this life. And all troubles don't go away for the repentant and the godly. We see that for the littles. Heard yesterday, you read from Tammy's Bible and the scriptures. She drank them in. She lived by them. She sought to walk in all of God's ways. Justice isn't always known in this life. It's the point Job now makes. Job's reply, chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. Job answered and said, "No doubt you are the people, and wisdom will die with you." I laugh at that. Wisdom, well, that's a great insult. You guys are so wise that when you die, all wisdom will be gone, because only you have wisdom. "No doubt you are the people, and wisdom will die with you, but I have understanding as well," meaning an understanding of God. "I'm not inferior to you," meaning an understanding of God, I'm not inferior in that. "Who does not know such things as these? Yet," you could say there, "I'm a laughingstock to my friends. I who called to God and he answered me, a just and blameless man, am a laughingstock." He's saying, I've had fellowship with God. I know God. I have a relationship with him. Yet now I'm a joke to people. I'm a laughingstock. Here I am, a man so blessed materially with family, and yet I've lost it all, and now people laugh at me. Painful. Painful. Continues on, 12:10. "In his hand is the life and breath," "in his hand is the life of every living thing and the breath of all mankind." True. He's talking about the power of God. He's going to show that his view of God is not in any way inferior to that of his friends, that of Zophar. And so he continues on, verse 13, "With God are wisdom and might. He has counsel and understanding. If he tears down, none can rebuild. If he shuts a man in, none can open. God is omnipotent." 16, "With him are strength and sound wisdom." Verse 23, "Not only is it individuals, it's nations. God's sovereign over nations. He makes nations great and he destroys them. He enlarges nations and he leads them away." He's saying, "I understand the sovereignty of God. I believe in the power of God that you're speaking of. I do. I do. And I see God as great and mighty." And he turns his words then to his friend. "Behold," verse 1, "behold, my eye has seen all this. My ear has heard and understood it. What you know, I also know. I am not inferior to you. But I would speak to the Almighty, and I desire to argue my case with God. I'd rather talk to him than you guys, because here's what he says about them. Verse 4, as for you, you whitewash with lies. Worthless physicians are you all. Oh, that you would keep silent, and it would be your wisdom. Oh, you guys were so much wiser when you didn't speak. That's what he's saying. Physicians to aid us, to comfort us, to help us in our distress physically, to diagnose our condition. These guys can't do any of that. They can't figure out what's going on. They're of no help, no blessing, no healing coming from them. They're worthless, worthless physicians. And yet in the midst of this context, what an incredibly glowing statement of faith we find. Amidst his bitterness of soul, he says in verse 15, though he slay me, I will hope in him, yet I will argue my ways to his face. He's saying, I want to speak to God and God alone. I don't want to deal with you guys. I want to talk to God. And here's what I'll tell you about God. Though he slay me, though God kill me, I will keep my hope. There's nothing God can do to me that will keep me from hoping in him. That's what he's saying. Incredible. When he feels so picked on, so overcome, so overwhelmed, so bitter, and yet he says, I'm still hoping in God. And even if you were to strike me to death, I'm going to keep on hoping in him. It's a glowing statement of faith. And then verse 23, he says, make me know my transgression and my sin. I want you to see that. Again, Job knew he was sinful. He's not saying he's not sinful. He's saying, God, just show me. Show me what I've done to deserve this. 14, 1 through 2, man who was born of a woman is a few of days and full of trouble. He comes out like a flower and withers like a, and he flees like a shadow and continues not. He's lamenting the brevity of life. And then finally, verse 14, he asks this question. If a man dies, shall he live again? If a man dies, shall he live again? What a question. A question that people have asked all over the face of the earth in every generation. If a man dies, shall he live again? Is there an afterlife? Is there anything after this? When we die, is there anything after this? A great question. And he asks it about all of humanity, not just for himself, but indeed for himself as well. He's asking, is there hope after death? And frankly, some pastors and scholars look at what Job's saying in this book and some other Old Testament writings as well, and they say, well, you know, Job didn't have a clear understanding of the afterlife. They viewed it as Sheol, the realm of the dead. And so this is the best he can do. He can wonder. He can ponder. He doesn't know. Oh, really? Well, have you read chapter 19, 25, and 26? We haven't here yet, but we will next week. He'll answer that question. And you'll see he does have a view of the afterlife. But today I simply conclude with this, telling you that what Job is asserting with this question is that the only way the senseless suffering of this life can make any sense is if there is another life, if there is a resurrection. Without that, all of humanity, he's asserting, is hopeless. But if we can live again, the implication is the sorrow and the injustices of this life become meaningful. It changes everything. Dinesh D'Souza, a bright Indian-American Christian apologist, philosopher, author, and speaker, has said it well in this way. He says, the only way for us to really triumph over evil and suffering is to live forever in a place where those things do not exist. It is the claim of Christianity that there is such a place and that it is available to all who seek it. He continues, no one can deny that if this claim is true, then evil and suffering are exposed as temporary hardships and injustices. They are as transient as our brief mortal lives. In that case, God has shown us the way to prevail over evil and suffering, which are finally overcome in the life to come. You see, the resurrection of Christ and of all who believe in him changes everything. Will you prevail over evil and suffering by trusting in the risen Christ, trusting into that heavenly intercessor, the arbiter who takes up your case, the advocate? For Jesus is not only the risen Christ, but as John 15:15 says, he's also your friend. And that friend, this friend, Jesus as your friend, is not the least bit unfriendly. Let's pray together. Father, I think of the old hymn, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." All our sins and griefs to bear. Lord, we thank you that you have called us friend and you've proven that you are a friend in a way that people never could by bearing our sins on the cross of Calvary. Lord, I thank you that it says in John 3 that you didn't come to the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through you. Lord, I pray that those here today who feel under the weight of their own sin would understand that you want to bear that weight. You're not pointing fingers at them, but you have open arms toward them. You want to receive them into your forever family. You want to take the burden of their sin and remove it forever. Give them fellowship with you, the Father, the Spirit, the people of God, now and forevermore. So I pray if there's one here today who doesn't know you as the intercessor, the arbiter, the peacemaker, that they would know you this day. For those who know you in this way, Lord, that we deepen in our appreciation, our love, and our adoration of you, for the one who was our sin-bearing servant, and the one who even allows us to call you friend. Lord, walk with us through the dark valleys. Help us to call out to you in our travail, as Job did, to even be honest with you, as we talked about last week, about the bitterness of our soul. But Lord, we thank you that Christ is alive, that he's risen, and because you live, we also can live. And justice will be done, and evil and suffering are conquered through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We thank you for those who've gone before us that taste the fruits of that resurrection that we only anticipate now by faith. So Lord, we thank you that death has been defeated, and we can know that here and now in these brief years of journeying on this earth, it can be well with us if we've entrusted our hearts, our lives, our souls to you. So we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're here today and you've never trusted in Jesus Christ and Savior and Lord, that he's calling you this very day to give him your life, to surrender your struggles and your directionlessness, your frustrations to him. He wants to be your redeemer. He wants to be your friend and journey with you through life. If you've never done that, I invite you to let us know. There's a card that was pointed out to you earlier that you can mark on there and put that in the offering plate when it comes by in a little bit. But you respond as God leads you. Also, we'll be here to pray with you if you will. Let's stand together and sing.
It is well.
It is well.
Your name is victory. All praise
of defeat, the resurrected King is resurrected. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrected. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of the resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrected. Borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not be made. Our God has robbed the grave. God has robbed the
now, if our ushers would come forward and we'll receive our offering.
Let us pray. Father God, we have worshiped you today, and now we're worshiping you with our tithes and our offerings, and ask that you bless each one that gives. And I ask you to take these monies and help us with our finances, and help us to set goals that will honor you, Lord. And so we ask these things and give you praise for what you accomplish in Christ's name. Amen.
Good Okay, our discipleship classes are going to be starting this afternoon at 5, and we have a short video clip there on one of those we're going to show right in a minute. There we go.
Hi, I'm Francis Chan. I want to tell you about a book that I just wrote. It's called Letters to the Church. And I called it Letters to the Church because when I was done writing, I just thought, this does not feel like a book. It feels more like just what I want to say to everyone after being a pastor for 30 years in America. Thinking through, like, gosh, we've strayed so far from what the Bible calls church. And it was a letter where I just thought, man, I just want to get us back to what we see in this book. We all know it. We all know, like, what we're experiencing right now is so radically different from what is in here. I mean, in fact, right now, I'm standing in the Jordan River, and I'm thinking about what was it like in the very beginning when John the Baptist was here, and he's talking about this one who is coming, and how he wasn't even worthy to untie his sandals, just the holiness, the understanding of how sacred God was. And I think I look back at my life, and I think of all the times where I treated the church as so common, like it's just another thing. And then I'm reading in Revelation, and I'm looking at how Jesus speaks to the churches, and his message to like 5 out of the 7 churches is, you better repent or else, you better repent or else. And you know, you just get to an age where you think, I have got to take this so seriously. That was one of the strongest warnings ever written, the book of Revelation, of what will happen if we don't get serious about the things of God. And so my heart in this book is not to judge or anything else. It's just looking back at my life and looking back at the way we did things. And I just wrote it thinking, okay, if I were to die tomorrow and go, what would I want to say to everyone from what I understand of this book and what I've experienced in the church for all of these years? And there's just a sense of urgency. Man, it's like if my wife was in ICU fighting for her life and I was out golfing or whatever else, and something would be wrong. And we have to understand, when we talk about the church, we're talking about the bride of Jesus. I mean, just like you would expect me to be at her hospital at bedside going, doctor, save her, take my lungs, take my heart. Her health is more important than me. Like, that's the way we've got to be about the church. Man, so many people have gotten frustrated because the church is unhealthy and they just leave her. And man, you understand that this book is about how Jesus is going to return one day. And you and I, we can't afford to just go about life and not care about his bride. When he returns, I want him to find me just giving everything I've got to bring health to the church. And that's what this book is about. My hope is that you also will see the need to just repent from this casual attitude and treat the church as sacred again.
Okay, now that you've got your second sermon of the day, that's a fantastic study there that we're going to have tonight. Chad and Melinda Haddon are going to be leading it. The others there, we've got some fantastic studies, some of the best that we've been offering. A ladies study, the other studies that are there, Rick's going to be leading his, Tom Van Allen his, and then visitation. If you come out and be a part of visitation, all of these are going to happen over in the 300 building, and those rooms are not listed there, but that study there with Chad, it's going to be upstairs in the 300 there in Kent Windham Sunday School class. The others will be downstairs, 311, 312, 313. So you'll be out this afternoon, 5 o'clock, 6-week short studies. They're all really great. So if you want to grow deeper in God's Word, there's your opportunity there. You want to grow deeper in serving the Lord, we've got a lot of opportunities. You'll see the mission trip to India we've been talking about several weeks. There's an informational meeting at 12:15, which is just in a little bit, down in room, conference room. go all the way down past through the fellowship hall, all the way to the end, turn to the right at the office, and we'll be right there. I think it's 310B. Real quick, there'll be a 15-minute meeting if you're interested in that India mission trip. Next Saturday, Men's Ministry Work Day. Men, you see that. We need you. We're going to be working here, and we've got a couple of jobs we may be doing on some other residents, but our main work is going to be right here. Breakfast at 7 o'clock. We'll start working at 7:30. I'll be here next Sunday morning. You'll see that we're going to be doing a lot of pressure washing, trimming, putting out mulch, cleaning up here around the church. And then over on the left-hand side, there's another opportunity if we're needing tutors. Our tutoring is starting back on Wednesday evenings, and then our Faith Finder Club will be Mondays. And yes, you can minister in both. Monday and Wednesday is a day in between for you to rest there. So we'll be teaching students that are coming over from our partner school at Hillcrest. They're here on Wednesday nights as we are Wednesday afternoons after school as we tutor them. And then we go over to the school in the school. They come here and we teach them, help them with their school lessons. And then on Mondays, we go to their school and teach them about Jesus. Isn't that cool that we still get to do that? So take advantage of that. We need workers in both of them. Tutors, see Becky Sims. Faith Finders, see my wife Lynn. And Chad, if you would come on, let's everyone stand. And Chad is going to dismiss us. Preach.
Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for being here with us. Thank you for speaking to our hearts. And this continued study of Job, Lord, one thing that touched me this morning was just how we should pray for those who rise up against us. There are times when discussion's necessary, but the most powerful thing that we can do is pray for them. And Lord, I just pray that we would pick out those people in our life that rise up against us, that persecute us, that make our days hard, and invest prayer into them. Lord, I pray for the small groups tonight. I pray that this congregation would respond, Lord, to this great program we have at 5 o'clock, and where we can get together and talk about you and create new relationships. And Lord, we just continue to pray for the Little family. Just bless them as they get to this new page of their life, Lord. We pray and ask these things in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you for watching this broadcast today of services from First Baptist Church in Lake Wales. We trust that you met with God as you watched the broadcast. And now may you know his blessings as you walk in obedience to his word.